receive the greetings of fire. In the name of Jesus, we thank God that has brought you here today. We thank God because you are here by the grace and by His will. We're going to the Word of God, and the topic of the message today: allow God to make you and use you. Allow God to make you and use you. When a manufacturer makes a product, when they develop the product, what it does, He gives instructions to the users that this is how this product works. This is how you operate it so that it can give you the best result. For example, when they make a cell phone, when you go and buy a cell phone, it comes with instructions. You are able to see what this cell phone can do and how you need to use it. Now, the cell phone itself does not make itself. It is made by somebody. Therefore, the cell phone cannot give the instruction of how it must be used. That is why, even if you can have the most expensive cell phone, if you put it down and you drive a car over it, it will not move because the user wants to use that cell phone like that. Now, if a cell phone has been designed and you want to make a call, and when you dial the numbers, the cell phone takes pictures. And when you want to take pictures, the cell phone dialed numbers. It means that cell phone is malfunctioning. It is not doing what it was meant to do. The one that made it, he knew in his mind that what I am making is supposed to function like this. If it does not do according to those specifications, it means whatever it does, it's malfunctioning. When we read in the Word of God, in the book of Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1 through 6, I'm going to read it in the Amplified Version, and it says, "The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will make you hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and saw that he was working on the wheel. But the vessel that he was making from the clay was spoiled by the potter's hand. So he made it over, reworking it and making it into another pot that seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, 'O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does?' says the Lord. Look carefully. As the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel." Allow God to make you and use you. The Bible says, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, and he says, "I want you to go to the potter's house. And when you are in the potter's house, I'm going to speak to you." When you arrive there, I want to speak to you. But I want to speak to you with things that you can see. So Jeremiah goes and he gets to the potter's house. And he sees the potter is working with clay on the wheel. And what he's doing is, when he makes something, and it doesn't come out the way he wants it to be, he reworks it. He does whatever he wants to do with the clay until the product that he wants is made perfect. Now, the clay that he uses has no say. It says nothing. When it's being reworked, it does not speak back. It doesn't say, but I feel I'm better like this. It doesn't say, but when you made me like this, I think I'm fine.
No,
the potter is obedient to the hand. The clay is obedient to the hands of the potter. So the potter does whatever he wants to do with the clay. Now God says, can I not do the same with you? You, my people, can't I work with you in my hands the same way the potter is doing with the clay? Can I not make you the way I want you to be? You see, in the past weeks, we were learning a lot. And God spoke to us so much about us not being a localized church. He spoke to us even last week about us not being blind because of the bribery and everything like that. Now, when God speaks to us and says, you are not supposed to be local, he is saying, you are in my hands. I want to take you where I want you to go. But he's saying, can't I do that with you? Now, there are times where people will say, but there are things that are not for us. They are for those people that are in the pulpit. I mean, we see a lot of people on the stage. It's for worshippers. It's for this and that. But God is saying, I have made you. I know what I want to do with you. Allow me to use you for the purpose that I made you for. If I made you to impact the world through prayer, it does not matter who can see you. You are an important vessel that I have made. I've made you. You see, everybody that is here today is important. You are a vessel that was made by God. So you are important to God. There is a role that you must play in taking this grace to the world. It's not for the committees. It's not for the pastors. It's not for the evangelists. It's for everybody that is here. If I were to ask you a question, how many parts are there in a car?
Zingaki inxenye ikhona emotweni.
And I'll follow up with another question. How many parts can you see in the car?
Zingaki ke lezo inxenye ongayibona wena emotweni.
When the car is moving,
imoto mihamba.
How many parts do you see?
Zingaki inxenye lezi ingxezo
yibona. But how many parts are there? If those parts that you cannot see can be removed, will the car move? Now that tells me the parts that we see and those that we do not see in the car are equally important. Now you sit there. God says, like the potter does with the clay, can I not do with you? If we are here and there are evangelists that have to travel to countries and preach the gospel, this is what is happening. When God made an evangelist that will travel the world, He also made somebody that will provide so that the evangelist can go. So you are there as an individual seated there and you are saying, but the evangelists are the ones that will go to the world. But God said, I will bring boxes that will be put in your church so that you can get the same opportunity to go where they are going. Even if you do not go physically, spiritually, you are contributing to what they are doing. You have been made for that. Let me tell you something. There are some people that will never stand here and preach. Not because they are useless, but because God has given them another work to do. Listen, you are a counselor and you feel you are not important, because even for you to be known, you have to put something that says counselor. But there are people that God has appointed for greater purpose, but they cannot reach there until they pass through you. There is a pastor that is supposed to preach, but he cannot preach before he confesses. You might not be seen, but let me tell you, allow God to make you and use you. Because God uses you the way He wants. You know, there are people that are so sensitive that if they can come to church, and when they do this to the chair, find that some dust, the whole service is spoiled. That is why God has put you, that you come and clean the chairs so that that soul will not be lost. This grace is not going to be taken to the world by just the few people who sit here. It is taken to the world by everybody that is here when we allow God to use us the way He wants to use us. You see, if I can go and buy a cell phone that takes beautiful pictures, but does not make a call, I will have a problem. Now, this church, in this grace, God has given us everything for it to be possible for the grace to be taken to the world. Maybe somebody was saying, these messages about us not being a localized church should be something they teach each other in those committee meetings, in those pastoral meetings, in those meetings of the evangelists. Those messages, they are preached to all of us because it is our responsibility, all of us, to move. The only problem that we have is that we have clay, or we are clay that speaks. We are clay that has opinions. We are clay that are full of suggestions. That is why we always think we can do better than the next person. So you are saying to God, God, you've made me to be a prayer warrior, but I can be a better evangelist. God, you've made me, and you have appointed me to be an usher, but I can preach better than them all. This is clay that is saying to God, the size you are making me to be, it's not good enough. This is a gadget that is trying to tell the user how to use it. When a vessel is made, it's not made for its own. It is made for the user. When God makes you, He's not making you for yourself. When God calls you as a pastor, you are not a pastor for yourself. You are not your own. You do not own yourself. You have an owner. His name is Jesus. When he says go, you go. When he says come, you come. When he says wake up, you wake up. When he says give, you give. When he says fast, you fast. Not so that you can get your car. You fast for the next person. He tells you, hey, do that. And you do it. How many of you have dreamt and you submitted, and the Lord says, the person that you saw in the dream, pray for them. And how many of us, after receiving that, have actually prayed for the people? How many of us could actually go and say, I'm going to go on a fast and pray for that brother and pray for that sister, because the Lord Jesus has commanded me to do so. It is much better to fast for ourselves. Lord, I can pray. You know me, I can pray for 7 days. When I want something, I can pray. I can fast for 7 days and I will receive it. Yes, it's good. But how much do you do it when it's the command from the Lord? I allow him to make you and use you. This is what it says in Jeremiah 1:5. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you and approved of you as my chosen instrument. And before you were born, I consecrated you to myself as my own. I have appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Isn't what God is saying? Say, Jeremiah. Before I formed you, I knew you. And now, God, when God says, I knew you, He's not saying, I knew how you would look like. He's not saying, I knew how tall or short you would be. He's saying, I knew what purpose you are supposed to serve. So when I made you, already there was a job. When I made you, there was work already for you. Before I formed you, I knew you. And I approved you as my chosen instrument. Not your own instrument. But I appointed you as my chosen instrument. Can I tell you today that seated there is a chosen instrument of God? I mean you who tells people that even if you are not a church, it does not matter because you do nothing at church. I mean you. The first thing you do on a Sunday morning is open the curtain and see if the weather is good for you to go to church or not. God says,
you,
I have chosen you to be my instrument. He says, before you were born, I consecrated you to myself as my own. Who do you belong to?
Ungoga bani wena.
Do you know why that cell phone of yours?
Uyazi ukuthi kungani lo makhalekhukhwini wakho?
Whether you want to download pornography on it,
noma ngabe ufuna ukuthatha izinto zabantu abanqunu,
it's downloaded.
Kuyenzeka lokho.
Whether you want to download messages,
noma ufuna ukuba nemlayezo,
it will be downloaded.
Kuzokwenzeka.
Because it's yours.
Ngoba ingeyo yakho.
You can do whatever you want to do.
Ngenza noma yini ufuna ukuyenza
ngayo. So if you want to use it for darkness,
uma ngabe ufuna ukusebenzisela ubumnyama,
you can use it.
Sebenzisa.
It will not say no.
Angeke wale.
Don't put this on me.
Ungafaki lokho kumina.
Now, God wants us to be like that. Where we say, Lord, what you want me to do, I will do. Where you want me to go, I will go. I will speak to whoever you want me to speak to, because I'm not my own. I belong to you. Father,
Baba,
download on me whatever you want to download. Put on me whatever you want to put. Make me. And use me. Make me. And use me. Church of Jesus Christ. There's too much work that needs to be done
out there.
There's a lot of preaching that needs to happen. The reason why the preaching is not going on is because the clay is talking. Lord, how do I even start? Just look at me. You know, sometimes we even have the audacity to go to God.
Nesibindi sokuya
nkulunkulu. God, do you know me? God, do you think I can do that?
Nkulunkulu, ucabanga ukuthi ngakwenza mina lokho?
But he's saying, I knew you.
Kodwa uthi ngakwazi nje.
I appointed you long ago.
Ngakukhetha kudala.
For this work.
Ngikukhethela
lo msebenzi. This work of taking the grace out.
Yabona lo msebenzi wokisa lo muso lengaphansi.
I chose you for it.
Ngikukhethele wona.
Long time ago.
Dala.
In Acts chapter 9.
What in Ezenzo 9?
When you read from verse 10 to 15, the Bible says, and there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said to him, arise and go into the street, which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth, and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in, and putting his hand on him, that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of these men how much evil he has done to thy servants at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. Now listen to this. This is when Saul met with the Lord Jesus. He was struck with lightning. And from there, the Lord spoke to him. That Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he was blind from there. Now listen. This man,
Ananias,
receives a word from God. This is not the Ananias and Sapphira that
were in
Acts chapter 5. Now, this one is the disciple. Now, he's told, you go to the house of Judas. When you get there, you will find a man. He's praying there. And he heard, he was told in a vision, that a man called Ananias will come and pray for him so that he can receive his sight. Now, Ananias says, Lord, we have heard about this man. We know what this man does to the Christians. We know that even here, he has authority to bind the children of God. This Ananias that you are talking about, we know this Saul that you are talking about. Hey, Lord, we know him. This man is telling God, you are sending me to a mission that is very dangerous. This man is hunting us, and you are sending me to him. We know this man. But listen to what God says. God says, hey, go to him. Because this man, terrible as you know him to be, I have chosen him to be my vessel. Now look at these two men. The other man has a reputation that when he sees you as a Christian, he binds you. You are in trouble when you meet him. Now there's a disciple who knows that there's this man. Now the disciple is sent to a man that he knows is hunting for him. And he says, oh Lord, this is something else. Can I tell you something? What if God speaks to you and he says, I want you to go on a fast for 7 days for your neighbor, the same one that is bewitching you. That The same one that is speaking against you. I want to bless that person. But for him to be blessed, you need to pray for him. How can I pray for blessings on somebody who is looking for my life? You see that man who impregnated you 15 years ago and he refused. God says, I want you to go and pray for him because he is sick. And he's not telling you to remind him about the child that he refused. He's telling you to pray for him. What do you do? Do you become clay that speaks? And say, I can pray for all of them. Lord, you can even tell me to go 40 days. As long as it is somebody else, not that one. When we speak of taking the grace to the world, we are not taking it only to those who favor us. It is going to those who don't even want to see you. The grace is good enough even for that one. That when he sees you, immediately he throws up. But we have been made by God for his own use. Now Ananias was told, you go. Why? There's something that you do not know. As much as you are my vessel as a disciple, he is also my vessel. I want to use him. But I cannot use him unless you pray for him. We have been made by God. He wants to use us for his own good, for his own purpose. Some of the work, it looks so difficult. It's tough. How can I do this? Lord, how can you ask me? I thought spreading the grace means standing there holding a mic and start to preach. I did not think cleaning toilets is part of it. Listen, everybody has a role to play in the kingdom of God. Everybody is important in this kingdom, in this grace. Let me tell you, you thought, I was talking to other people one day. They said, is it good? Because the Bible says, he who desires the office of a bishop must be one that is not given to drink. Why? He must not have many wives. He must be a husband of one wife. He must be able to control his children. Then they said, does that mean that if I do not desire the office of a bishop, then I can marry more than one wife? Then I said, but why? He said, because I'm just an ordinary member of a church. So because I'm not a pastor, I'm an ordinary member. And the Bible says, those that desire this must have one wife. I don't desire it. Then I asked the question. I said, from that, can I ask you? Maybe I can answer from there. Because the Bible says, you must not be given to drink. You must not be a drunkard. Does that mean that ordinary church members, as you say, can be drunkards? Does it mean that if you are an ordinary man in the church, it's good that you do not have control over your children? The problem is, once you put yourself in the back seat and say, I'm an ordinary person in the church, I just go and go home. I go and go home. When I feel like not going, I sit at home and nobody recognizes that I'm not there. When you put yourself in that position, it is easy to sin. Even if I sin, who will see me? Even God doesn't see me. He doesn't care about me. I just go to church and then go home. But if you understand that I am a vessel, I have been chosen by God, this thing has nothing to do with positions according to the positions in the church. It's got everything to do with my position in the kingdom. And my position in the kingdom is that of a child of God. And when I'm a child of God, I will do what God says I must do. Pastor Lazarus said it many times. He said, I'm a child. He said, I am just a child. He said, I'm not a pastor. I'm a child. You see, the most wonderful position in a family is that one of a child. Do you know that when you are struggling and thinking what you are going to cook, the child is not worried about that. The child just wants to eat. So children do not have those problems. Now, when you are a child in the kingdom, allowing God to use you, you don't have a problem of how you will get to Zimbabwe, how you will get to Botswana, how you will get to the United States, how you get to the United Kingdom. The one that wants to spread will use you. You obey. Because you're a child. When he says pray, you just pray.
We are kulega.
You wake up. He wakes you up in the morning. And he says, pray. You wake up. You don't even know where to start. But immediately when you say fire. 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 Then he reveals what you need to pray for. And you pray. And you pray. And you see somebody prospering. You don't even tell them that I prayed for you. You don't say, hey, my brother, you see this car, I prayed for it. You say, praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. He is faithful. Let me tell you, God is not only faithful when he provides for you. He is faithful when he provides even for others that you pray for. He has made you for his own use. He has made you for his own use. Praise be to Jesus.
Praise the Lord.
Listen to this. In the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 20 and
21.
Listen, now in a large house, there are not only vessels and objects of gold and silver, but also vessels and objects of wood and of earthenware. And some are for honorable, noble, good use, and some for dishonorable, ignoble, common. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from these things which are dishonorable, disobedient, sinful, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified, set apart for a special purpose, and useful to the master, prepared for every good work. Can I tell you this? When we get rid of disobedience and sinful lifestyle, we become honorable vessels. We become vessels of honor. And these vessels of honor, the master uses them for good work. Sin
isono
pollutes you, pollutes us, so that we are not able to be used as vessels of honor. If we give ourselves to the sinful nature, we are actually saying to God, don't use
me.
But when we allow God to cleanse us, when we become pure, now God is able to use us. I might not know now what I can do, but when you are pure and get rid of disobedience, then God will let you know what you need to do. This church, everybody that is here, when we are obedient to God, God will give us. He will use us the way he wants to use us. We might not be seen that God is using us by people, but he will be using us. I will not forget when the man of God said, you don't even know who is number one in this church, according to God. It took me time, and I wanted to understand, what does it take for one to be in that position among so many people? And I realized it has nothing to do with what people can see, but it has everything to do with what God can see. Because when he speaks, when he wants to use you, you allow him to use you. Those that are called honorable by God are those that are obedient and allow him to use them. Those that allow God in every situation to use them, to him they are honorable. You see, there's a problem today where people who are made by God for his own work, you know, they are happy to be made and appointed as pastors and prophets, but when it comes to him using them, they say, no, I will do it my own way. I know you have called me to be an evangelist,
no,
but I'll take it from here. Now, if you're going to send me anywhere, and wherever you send me, they must send me the details of the accommodation first before I leave. It reminds me of a testimony that was given by evangelist Claudius one day. It sounded funny. But to me it was, if we are to be used by God, we cannot have opinions. We cannot say to the Lord, you can use me only in this and this and that. I'm a pastor. Before you can invite me, tell me how many people are in your church. Because I'm not coming to preach to five people. So I agree to what God has made me to be. But when it comes to working, I have my own rules. So if you want to take a picture, I don't take a picture. I dial a number. I know you have called me for this. But only when it suits me. Allow God to make you and use you. I'm a worshiper. But there are some things that I don't do. So if you are wearing that uniform, I'm not coming on
stage.
Doesn't suit me. You are made not for yourself. You are made so that God can use you. Use me.
Use me.
Lord, just use me. Just use me. I was telling my wife yesterday, I said there are things when God speaks, I'm not going to ask you. I'm coming to tell you. If God says this is what I must do, I'm not coming for an opinion. I am bringing information. I'm not a stubborn man. But when God speaks, He has spoken. When God spoke to
Abraham,
Abraham took the child and he left.
Wahama.
He did not tell the wife what he was going to do. He left.
Wahama.
Pastor Roth said one day,
hey,
there are some ships that must be abandoned. There are some friendships that must be cut off because it is not cool for them to be a holy children of God. It's time to cut them off. I'm not saying I'm going to cut my wife off. I am saying when God speaks, I will stand and say, Lord, I obey. And I will say, as for me and my family, we shall do what God says. As for me and those that are my family, we shall go where God says we must go. So that means if I tell her, she must ask who said that. And I will say it is God. And she must say it is well. I might be preaching things that you don't like. But I think I must speak the truth. When God speaks, there's no time for negotiation with anybody. And let me tell you something. When God has spoken, and truly He has spoken, there is no way that He will cause conflict. The only time when there will be conflict is when somebody said, God said, and God did not say anything. Because He said, I knew you before you were born. I have prepared these things for you. So even those that are supposed to support you, I have already put them in place. You know, I know it's very difficult for us even to tithe because we have not yet finalized the negotiations at home. Whether we should tithe or not. The wife is saying, I'm tithing. The husband is saying, no. And these people are not in different churches. They are both here. It is time to allow God to use us. Let me tell you, it's not easy sometimes. It takes a sacrifice. It takes somebody saying, if I die, let me die. But let me die in the presence of the Lord. Sometimes it's not easy. You know, I usually say, when I'm not in prayer, I can go the whole day without eating. And I don't have a problem. But when I'm supposed to pray, 4 o'clock before I even wake up, I am so hungry. But what God said must be done. If I'm going to die of hunger, let me die. But I'm not going to refuse God because I woke up hungry. Lord,
Ghost,
make me
Genze,
and use
me.
This is my prayer. That Lord, I don't want to say no to you. Use me. Let me tell you, there are times when you wake up and you feel like I just don't want to do anything. But God has work for you that you must do. You need to get up and do it. The work of God must be done. What God commands must be done. What God has wants to be done must be done. That is why husband and wife, you must be able to pray together so that whatever God says to this one, the Spirit of God will confirm to this one. Then there will not be conflict. The work of God will be done. What if God tomorrow says, in Zambia, there must be
kufanele
the 5-point plan.
Kube nehlelo lamaphuzu amahlano.
It must happen there.
Kufanele lwenzeke lapho.
Immediately.
Ngokuphuthuma.
And it says, Ropiwa.
Besethi Ropiwa.
You are going there.
Hamba eZambia.
He doesn't tell you what kind of an accommodation you're going to get. But you must go there. It It's up to you to give him reasons why you cannot go. Or just to obey and go. Those that God has called, he always provides for. If he has called you for that work, he will provide for you. If you get up and you go to
Zambia,
and it will be you and your family there, you don't know anybody. You don't even know where to start. The one that sent you there has already prepared people to welcome you. He has already prepared a platform for you. Because when you say, yes, Lord, everything that needs to be done will be done. I always say, we can all live.
Sonke singahamba.
I mean, all of us here.
Uthina sonke la.
We can all live.
Sonke singahamba.
But nobody
kodwa kunamuntu
can kill his will.
Ongabulali his will.
We 5 years later we'll stand and say, but we started it. But nobody can stop the work of God. If you allow him, you will reap what God has for you. But if you disobey, it does not mean that the work of God will be done. It will be done. Jesus said one day, if these people keep quiet, the stones will praise me. To use you.